everybody. It's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we are separating and winterizing our tender bulbs. So after you dig them up, which is a big task in itself, you have to prepare them. I mean, this is not something you want to keep all winter in your basement. It takes up too much room, and we have a lot that we need to winterize. So what we've done is take off all of these roots, most of the stem, and then they're ready. First we washed them. I should say Rick washed them.
That took hours.
That took hours because they're full of soil, and the soil has been on them all summer, so it's embedded in all these little roots.
It's kind of like how you give me a haircut.
It is. Here.
Just start hacking away.
Make sure I don't take off your ear.
Well, I appreciate that.
So do I. Okay, so doesn't have to be down deep. It just needs to be, some of this has to come off.
Well, they'll just shrivel up anyhow.
They will. And if they're too close and compacted together, you never know. You know, if they're going to start to mold, and the whole thing will be gone. I think I can get it with this one. So then I'm taking off most of this. Again, it just takes up too much room. And then I can put it in my ready-to-dry, ready-to-cure area. So that's one that had a stem. This one we took the stem off already. So this one seems to be a very healthy, big grouping, so I'm not going to do anything with this one except take off these roots. Once these roots are off, we're going to set them out on a table outside where they can get sun and air to dry them off. And that helps kind of cure them too. It's like, okay, we are done growing now for sure because we're not in the soil anymore, so let's just get ready for winter.
Is that the same scissor you use when you cut my hair?
No.
Oh.
Do you want me to?
No.
You want me to use this one? I'll be happy to. Okay. Good enough. Good enough. Into the bucket you go. Next.
So. Let's take this over
mm-hmm. And
spread them out.
Let's do it. This is the south side of our house, so it should get a lot of sun, and that's fine. Set them out right here. Now, you don't need to be real, real gentle with these, but you don't want to bruise them either. So just set them out gently and make sure there's some air space between them.
Air supply?
Air space.
Oh.
You can see how some of these, I mean, they're mammoth. They're just really large. They have grown, I think, more
this year than
this
ever.
This year than ever.
Yeah. I mean, some of these clusters, when I were washing them, weighed at least 50 pounds. And they're probably, if you took what you have on the table,
mm-hmm. That
wouldn't even make two clusters that
I know.
Separated.
I know.
In fact, this may be three clusters just here.
This
Amazing.
Was a very good year for cannas.
Yeah.
And dahlias.
Now, there's no way you're going to be able to store all of these because you probably have at least, I'd say 150, maybe even more, yet to go. What are you going to do with all of these?
Well, if you live nearby, and you want to stop by, give us a call, and maybe we can supply you with some. But
well,
that means you have to take care of them for the winter. You can't just say, oh, good, thanks, I'll plant them. You can't plant them now. You're going to have to put them in an open box, some newspaper on the bottom, and spread them out a little bit. Every month, at least once a month, you go down with a little spray bottle, and you just spray them. And you check for any mold or mushiness. That's it. Then come next spring, that's when you plant them.
You know, you have a shadow on your face right now that makes you look like you have a mustache and a really heavy eyebrows.
That's my Halloween disguise.
Oh, that's your costume for tonight.
Yes.
See, I thought we should leave these out on the front porch, and when the kids come trick-or-treat, we said, grab one.
No, they would probably try eating them.
Probably.
One of our other tender bulbs was the Peruvian daffodil, which is absolutely spectacular as far as a flower goes. When we bought these, maybe they were this size. And they didn't have these on them.
All right.
And they didn't have a big stem on them. They were just like this. Now this one has pretty much been torn apart because it was just so hard to get out of the container. So I'm not going to save this one. I'm not going to save it because if it contaminates the others by getting ill or soggy or messy, then I don't want it. So I'm just going to cut this down like that and cut this off. You see how floppy this is already, so there's really no purpose for that. So it's just going to be that.
It's like a big onion.
Mm-hmm. Sort of does look. And look at it. It kind of has like a red. Like it's bleeding. Sorry.
Ouch, ouch, ouch. Did you hear it?
I believe that was you.
Oh.
And again, floppiness. Might even want to peel some of this off. Not too deeply. That's enough. And please disregard these ginkgo leaves because our tree is about to drop on us.
It has been dropping, but not completely.
No, I think the weather really has it
confused.
Because last year, instead of turning yellow and then dropping all its leaves, it dropped them when they were green. And this year, it slowly turned yellow. And yet, it hasn't dropped all its leaves in a singular bunch like it usually does. Unless it starts getting windy suddenly, we're going to be snowed upon.
I generally have to take the blower, go up on the roof, and just to blow all the leaves off there. Otherwise, they end up clogging the screens and the gutters.
Yep.
I mean, you can see what's been happening already.
We've been decorated. Okay, so these are much easier to take care of than cannas.
Oh my goodness, I tell you, I probably spent a good 4 hours just trying to wash them off yesterday, and what, maybe another hour and a half today, if not more?
Yes.
And even then, when we divided them further, there still was soil in the root system.
Yep, I had to rewash those.
Well, some of them were like they were on top of each other. It was like a 5 to 7 layer cake.
Yes,
there were bulbs on top of bulbs on top of bulbs, or tubers.
And we know that it's not just here because our son, who's closer to the lake than we are, and the lake does play a part in the climate, they're warmer during the winter. So his cannas were also crazy, just crazy. He planted 9 of them from the one clump of bulbs that we gave him 2 years ago.
Yep.
And he got 9 of them. And when he dug them up, he figures he has at least, what did I tell you, 150?
I think so. I mean, they just went berserk.
So he's intending to share them with his entire neighborhood if they want them, and they're going to become the canna neighborhood. Okay, so these now can go and get put out on a table or in a wire basket that we have.
I'll go put those away. Peck, let's do the elephant ears first.
You can
put that
in. That's a good idea.
And I'll keep those together.
Okay. Now, elephant ears. You can see how big this plant can be. I mean, they can get this tall, and leaves are huge.
Yeah.
So you want to take off this huge part. And we were so happy to see that there was some actual root there, a big root ball.
Oh, look at the little babies, though.
Right, and these are the babies. Now, last year, I don't think they had enough time to do anything but grow, and they didn't really have much of a bulb on them, and none of them made it.
Well, we had to buy new ones this year.
We did. These are our new ones, and they, while they were smaller, they did very nicely. And hopefully they'll make it through the winter, and then we can plant them again.
Yep. Well, I wouldn't think you'd want to keep any of that slimy connection on there. It would just
invite
diseases and who knows what.
Yes. So you're going to take as much as possible off without harming the bulb itself.
And that's another reason why you want to spend a little time drying the bulbs before you actually put them down in a cool, dark place.
Yep. But see, all of that is just part of the root system and part of the skin over the top of it, if you want to call it skin. Odor layer.
Who is that character in Pirates of the Caribbean?
Yes, Davy Jones.
Yeah.
Remember, he reminded us of our rhubarb when we dug our rhubarb that time. Okay, so now this one has two major spouts coming off of it, and it's got this big bulb here. Now, oops, see?
It's soft.
It's soft and it's squishy. So this one is not going to make it. If I can get these guys off, we'll have a chance of at least saving that. We'll give it a try.
Yeah, maybe.
At least it's firm. Now juicy. And then there's this one. And that looks good. That looks nice and healthy in there. Mm-hmm. So we'll just take these off. Again, every month or so you need to go down or to go wherever you're storing them in a cool, dry place. Dark as well. They like to be dark. You're looking for soft areas. You're looking for any mold or mildew that seems to be growing on them. And if you find that, you just really need to get rid of it. Okay. Goodbye. So bugs out here.
Yeah, those flies or whatever they are just keep attacking me.
Yes. All right, now let's see what this one looks like. Yeah, that's mushy right there. You can see.
Yeah. Can you cut that out with a knife?
I can try it. I know one year I tried that. It seemed to work.
Yeah, it really has some nice protrusions.
Mm-hmm. They're so pink. Which is funny because none of the part that's above ground has any pink.
Okay. Do you have your knife?
I thought I had my knife out
here. Yeah, I thought you said you did too.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me
go get it.
Okay, it's right inside the door there.
Inside the door?
So this part is nice and solid. This is not, but this is solid. So it's just this part right here that needs to come out. How will I do that? You can kind of see how it's brown there, kind of slippery. So definitely don't want that.
It's like a potato.
Yes, that's just what I was going to say. It's, in fact, I think some places people use this as like a potato part to eat. Okay, I think I need a smaller, like a scoop to scoop that out.
How about a spoon?
I'll go get a spoon.
Okay.
And now you see where it's brown right there, so that's got to come out.
Like a dentist.
You have a cavity and I'm taking it out.
Without Novocaine.
Yeah.
Be careful when you're using sharp instruments. Have to put up a disclaimer.
Okay, so I'm going to leave it at that. And then for sure, I'm going to be watching to see what happens. Look at all these little guys.
Yeah.
Hopefully they all stick around. This kind of feels soft right here. So like I said, I'll be watching this one. Well, this is day four. This process isn't done quickly if you have a lot of tender bulbs. These are the cannas that we got that we felt were good enough to save. Quite a few of them.
Well, you've already given some away.
I have given some away because we just, you know, why not share?
Yeah.
And if you know the people are going to take care of them over the winter, that's wonderful. So these will be sitting out here for at least one more day. Tomorrow, well, today's in the 70s, tomorrow will be in the 70s, and then it's going to rain and get colder. So this is perfect drying time for them.
And this is the 2nd of November.
I know. It's just amazing.
Incredible.
Yes.
I'm out there short sleeve shirt.
I know. We made use of these drying racks, which came in very handy. We had some of the cannas over here because we had so many of them. And once I took them over to the other table and did the trimming, that freed up this one. Okay, so then I'm looking in this one. And here are the Peruvian daffodils, which I have trimmed down to just a short stalk and that much root.
It's like a scrub brush.
Or an onion with big... Yeah. Big thing. So we have some little ones that were very tiny when we started in the spring, and they were in pots.
Containers?
Containers, right, little containers. And they have grown, and then these were the larger ones that just grew larger. These are the elephant ears. And trimmed those off, and they have been curing and drying out, but you can see babies coming, and that's, we love seeing that. That shows you there's progress. Now over here are all the daffodils, no, dahlias. And these were the tiny little dahlias. We were very selective on just picking a few of them. These were the ones that came in a 18 or 12 foot, 12 inch flat, right. This one is the special yellow one.
The starburst? Or
the starburst, right.
The starburst.
Right. And I will be writing right on the roots of this one because I know that this one is this one.
Well, I know you wrote on one of them when
yes,
I was
it's up
washing.
There. Okay. Right. Yep. And I believe these are all what's called the blue bell, but they're really purple. They're not really blue. But we had a lot of them, and I think I have more of them that kind of got separated from the others. But that's okay, because once I plant them in the spring and they blossom, then I can write down what they are. These are another kind. This was the orange ones. The These were that beautiful orange clumpings.
That's a different type of
It's a different bulb. And I don't know if that's because it's a different kind or if they just didn't get a chance. But, I mean, they did very well.
Yeah. And what do you have up in this other rock?
Now, up in this other rock, I don't know what these are.
Well, we know they're dahlias.
Yes, they're dahlias, and they got kind of separated. The one I hope we have, I think that one is it, is the red one, which I wanted. And here's the one that last year, I believe it was Mary Playford, said that she writes right on the...
I don't know if I can see that. It's kind of dark.
Oh, let me lift it up again.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's called Garden Wonder. And I know I have two of those. Yes,
yeah.
And
that was the one that I saw.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was surprised that it made it through the entire summer and it didn't wash off and it didn't shrink down like I thought it would.
Well, maybe that's what we have to do next year when we're...
planting.
Well, I think when they're flowering, so that we can clearly identify them and then somehow make sure that when we dig them up,
we know
we're writing on them.
Right. This one, I believe, these two big healthy bunches, I believe are pinks. We had a lot of pinks and they were very healthy.
Those are amazing clusters of tubers. Wow.
Yes. And this is another, I'm saying it's pink, as are those. But I wanted to show you that, you know, you can chop these off, these little endings here.
They're already dried out.
Right. So, you know, you're not going to be seeing any growth off of those. And it's just eliminates some of the hiding places where problems can get started. And you can also take these old shrinking ones off. But what I wanted to show you is... the new growth does not come out of these. It comes off of the actual stem. And you can see where it's coming. There and there. That's where the growth takes place. So these are just storage areas for energy. But that's where the actual growth takes place. I think this was another one. Where did I see that? Yeah, like right along there. Cool. Which always, you know, that surprised me when I figured that out last year. That's where it comes from. See that one?
Yeah, several.
So I've pretty much trimmed these off. That's good. And then over here are the fragrant gladiolus. These were the ones, they had the really tall leaves. We had them in a container.
Were the ones up blossoming, that were still blossoming next to the pond?
Yes.
The waterfall?
Yes, and they were like a white with blue in the middle. I mean, totally different from a gladiola that we normally are used to seeing. So these were full of little bulblets. Now... whether all those little bulblets next year will also turn into plants, possibly. They keep falling off.
Isn't this... oh, no. I thought that was a new little shoot starting to come up.
Oh, no, I just... part of that. Yeah. So, carefully, we're going to be winterizing these and placing them in a safe place. But we wanted you to see the bulblets, and we wanted to see how you chop off. You don't need to keep all of that leaf on there. The leaf part is done. Thank you, leaf part. You
now,
did great.
Could you take these back even farther?
I probably could, but this will make it easier to put them in and lift them up without touching the bulbs themselves. Now, you probably wonder, why am I wearing a mask? I'm outside. There's nobody around except Rick. Peat moss is very hard for your lungs to... except it's not good. It's dusty. It has obviously has
microbes
in there as well as fungus of some kind. So I'm putting this in just a regular cardboard box with paper on the bottom. and you see all the dust, ricks and upwind. And this will be my base for the dahlias. Now I can already feel that it's not damp, but it's not dry either. And that's fine. Just gonna put a little bit more in here. Thank you, sir. Okay, and then I'm gonna spray it a little bit with some water. Oops, wrong one. There you go. Just to dampen it a little bit more. And that's about it. I don't want to get it too damp. Then you just take your clump and set it in. Snuggle it down in there. Group here.
Well, you don't want to layer them or overcrowd them either.
Correct. Now, I'm trying to remember, did I put some peat moss on the top the last time?
I think you put burlap over them, yes, so that you could get down and inspect them.
Correct. Okay, so then I'm just going to put burlap. You could just put a loose piece of newspaper on top. And about once a month, I'm going to take my spray bottle and I'm going to spray them just about that much, no more, and then just leave them in there in a dark, cool place. The coolest place you have in your basement, that's good for them.
Could be a closet, someplace that, you know, if you don't have a basement, I would not put it out in the garage if you're in this temperature because they will freeze.
Yeah, if it's an attached or a heated garage, then you're okay, but for us, the coolest place is the basement. And it likes to be dark. It needs to be dark so they don't think, oh, I should be growing. It's bright out.
Do you realize how many boxes you're going to have this year?
A lot.
My goodness.
Well, now let me do these little guys over here. I'll be right back. Peat moss is not the only medium you can use when you're storing your bulbs. If you have a paper shredder, you could use that. If you wanted to use sand, you could do that. Some people take plastic wrap and just totally wrap their whole clump of anything up in that. This is a more open container, and I think these would do better in this kind of container. And these I think I can just have standing up, or I could put them down. You don't want to crowd them, but you don't have to be real careful either. And there you go. Okay, so close together, but not crowded. Now I can also, I think, put the elephant ears in here. Since we don't have a whole lot of elephant ears, I think
how about the Peruvian daffodils?
Oh yeah, I could use those. Okay. Yeah. Now, I know from the past that these guys are not picky. They're very happy being semi-dry. No problem. And then again, give them a little spritz. And once a month, just come down. Don't get them soggy. Just spray them a little bit.
And these two you'll be covering with burlap.
Yes. We know from past experience that cannas do just fine if you lay them flat on some newspaper and don't be covering them with anything. But if you've used something before, don't be afraid to use it again. Whatever works for you, whatever you have available.
Well, the great thing about gardening is there are a lot of different ways, successful ways to do things, and not just one method is the only method.
That's right. So this will just be lying open-faced in the basement. Okay.
So you're not even going to cover these?
No, probably okay. not. But again, once a month.
In other words, you're going to need 5 more trays, at least.
Or I do have paper bags, like your grocery bags, for things that don't need a lot of media that's going to be wet. You could use paper bags.
I would use just one. Just put a couple in there, and then you can stand them upright.
Maybe.
You could even lie the bag sideways and, you know, fill it that way. And
yes. Yep, so. I could do that.
But I think it'll work better this way. And that's it for that one.
And you could cut this bag down, too, to the fold here so that you yes. have just open little pouches.
But this nice
tab. Be a lot easier. Yeah. So I'd say you have your work cut out for you. Oh, there was one other thing I wanted you to show, and that's how you save your liatris.
Oh, liatris.
Let's go show
Many
that.
People, if you've watched before, I love liatris. That's sometimes called
purple
bonnet, or it's a native plant, and it does just lovely in our climate. So every year I grow it, and every year I can't resist collecting the seeds. Liatris is known by several different names depending on where they grow and who sees them first. They are a native, so in our climate, 5B, they grow very well. It's also called gay feather and blazing star. Liatris is just easier for me to remember because that's what I've always called them. After they have blossomed, this is what the seeds look like. And if you want to save them, you just don't touch them until they're all puffy and dry like this. For me, it's just easier to snip them off, hold them over a bucket, and run your hand over them. So it's fun, it's easy.
Now you'll start sprinkling those at this time of year. In bare spots, right?
Right. So if you have an open spot that has soil that's open, you can sprinkle them now. Because when the snow falls and waters them, and then in the spring the sun will shine on them, they will start growing right away. Otherwise, you can wait until spring. No problem. Again, just an open soil area and sprinkle them down and give them some water, and away they go.
Well, the first year they look like grass, so you might mistake it as being a weed or something like that.
Yes, it looks like a wider grass, and if you're ever in question, just pull one up, and if it has a little tiny corm on the bottom, like a little fat root bulb down there, then you know it's liatris, and you can just tuck it back in. But don't fret if you suddenly see a bunch of grass and you say, I don't want grass there.
Plus, it won't blossom the first year.
No, it won't.
So.
And it does come in different colors. It comes in 2 different kinds of purple, and it also comes in white. I don't know, maybe it'll come in pink sooner or later, but we've never seen pink.
Well, I know that you have an entire hedge of liatris right here that you still haven't gotten to.
Yes.
And most of this comes from other parts of your yard. I mean, right. We're talking about a 5-gallon pail here.
Yep. I've got them here, there, and everywhere. The bees, especially the bumblebees, love it. And they are, you know, they're tall, but they're not giant. You can stick them in anywhere. And probably in the beginning of August, they will start blooming, and they'll bloom for a long, long time.
Yeah. It's interesting how they bloom, too. They start at the bottom and
That's right.
work their way upward.
Yes. Most flowers will start, if they're a stalky flower, it'll start blossoming at the top and work its way down. With this one, it starts at the bottom and works its way up.
Now, you talked about bare soil.
I
can only think of this spot right here.
Uh-huh.
And just beyond the Montauk daisies, that's about the only bare spot soil that we have on this property, yeah, other than our raised beds, which you keep for veggies and other things.
Right.
So how the heck do you find all these bare spot areas? Because you've got liatris growing everywhere.
I do. And I don't know. I often give a big chunk of what I gathered to the Monarch Watch people, because they know places that need to have some kind of
butterfly-friendly
habitat, and they're always very happy to get the liatris.
I'm sure these will not go to waste.
No, they won't. We hope you enjoyed this video and maybe learned a little bit about how we store our tender bulbs.
That's
interesting,
a
plant. Yes, yeah. Very interesting roots, and always purpley. Fun. People in the Bayview area, you may be having a surprise come spring, but we'll leave that to Keith. If you did enjoy, please give us a thumbs up. We truly appreciate that. And if you'd like to see other videos, there is our website, wisconsingarden.com, that shows some of the ways we've done it in the past and some of the suggestions people have had. If you have suggestions and would like to share them with others, we will pass that along too. Also, if you'd like to become part of our garden family, there is over here a little orangey red button that you can tap. If you're already a subscriber, thank you very, very much. We truly appreciate that as well. And then there's a little bell up here, a little icon of a bell, and you can tap on that, and when a new video comes up, it will let you know. Oh, they're at it again. Stay healthy. Happy Thanksgiving coming up. Oh, decorations. And be happy, be kind, and we'll see you again soon. Bye for now.
Connect with us on YouTube.